All right, the UPS guy has just made his delivery and has taken off. We can just jump right in because there's no time to lose. I make these videos and try to say, share a lot here that is you won't hear other places. Has to be very much on the cutting edge of what's being said. Otherwise, why even bother? You know, why just repeat what others are saying? So this here has a very different flavor to it. And just to give you an idea of how I see my schedule going forward for the rest of 2012, I'm hoping that October, November, December, I'll be in a different situation than I am now. We'll see. It seems to, it could shape up that way. Those are critical months. I believe by that time we will simply be too confused on the subtle levels to be able to focus there. It's already becoming extremely difficult to focus on the subtle levels. I know that there's prophecy that says in the end times things will be so bad that even the elect, the saints of God, will be in danger of slipping into delusion. And we're at that time. That's unbelievable. The disconnect between the external, what we're told we're supposed to focus on, what we think we want to focus on, and what we really want to focus on, that disconnect is just growing ferociously. And it's unbelievable. It's hard to go back and forth, really tough to go back and forth right now. During the daytime, I'm working, functioning. I can't really focus beneath the surface. And then these videos give us the opportunity to look beneath the surface. And it's a discipline, but it's doable. But the disconnect is so extreme. You know, going back and forth, you just say, whoa, I'm going back and forth between two different worlds, or more than that, between two different belief systems that are becoming more and more starkly delineated, and they don't have really anything in common, which is very true. You cannot escape this world. You cannot, however, you can escape the cause of this world. That is absolutely the key of what I've been teaching in hundreds of videos. I have hundreds of videos that I haven't uploaded yet from years gone by that are saying the same thing. You cannot escape this world, but you can escape the cause of this world. And when you escape the cause, there is no more world, as it were. You can't have your cake and eat it too. You cannot hold on to the cause of this world and then escape the effects that cause brings. That is impossible. And yet, that's the very thing we believe and think and trust and have faith is possible. That is the very thing we're trying to do, that existence is trying to do. And we look at all these dynamics of existence and we think, oh my gosh, existence is so powerful, that we want to see what kind of power existence can conjure up. Okay, bottom line is it can never conjure up any power. Only reality has power, and the laws of reality cannot be changed. So there is no power outside of reality, and yet we are trying to come up with one. Existence is nothing but the manufacturing of death. That's all that it is. All that existence ever does is manufacture death. And it is trying to parlay death into a power. Okay? Into a power. Because then it wants to parlay that power of death into deal-making with the Prime Creator. And it wants to get the Prime Creator to agree to change a little bit of reality. Just a tiny little bit. The smallest tiny little bit, as a sign of reconciliation with us, like we say. And we're using this power of death that we think that we are going to come up with to frighten the Prime Creator into making that little change in reality, knowing full well that this would we think that it would give us then the opportunity to become Prime Creator. What it would do, it would annihilate reality. It can never happen. But that is what we're trying to do. So we are this existence simply manufactures death. And, you know, look at that a little more closely than you have before. realizing that how do you manufacture death? You know, seem like, huh, how's that possible? First, you have to manufacture something that you define as life. And then that what you define as life has to lose its life, right? So you have to do that, of course. All we've ever done, all that existence has ever done, is manufacture death. That is the sole activity there is. It's not manufacturing life, it's manufacturing death. And it manufactures fake life, which then succumbs to death. And then we think we're parlaying this, eventually we're building up a power. Building up some kind of power is taking a lot of time. We agree, oh, it's taking a long time, but we're almost there. We've almost built up enough of this evidence that it'll somehow ignite into a power. And then we'll go to the Prime Creator and say, Prime Creator, we have this new power. Didn't come from you, came from us. And if you don't make a deal with us, we're going to utilize this power on you and wipe out reality. But we'll make a deal, we'll spare you, we'll spare reality, but you just have to change a little bit of it for us as a peace offering, so to speak, as a sign of submission to us. And we're trying to trick the Prime Creator that way. And this trick depends on us having some power that the Prime Creator doesn't have. And this power we're trying to get is the power of death, which death has to be power over life. Otherwise, the term death is completely meaningless. You can't take a handful of nothing and say it died. Nothing there to die. You have to take a handful of something that you define as life, and then it has to die. You kill it, and then you say, ah, you see, I have some power over life. That is all we're doing in existence. That's it. And it's a futile quest, entirely futile quest. I say this over and over and over and over and over again. And it's I don't feel it's really sinking in. And so I'm looking at, why does this not sink in? And the truth is that it's taken me a long, long time to just be able to say these things in this world. There's an enormous resistance to it. Enormous resistance. And it may not take root here. It's very possible. And I think I only have about 6 more weeks. By the time that October 2012 rolls around, I think people are going to be so confused that they may not be able to even focus on these things. That's which is why I've been pushing these things for really the last 2.5, 3 years, last 15 years intensely, but last 2.5 years, 3 years, all out. And it's really, I understand that it's really too tough for most people here. And I don't judge anyone at all for that, you know. It's because it is tough. It does require a background. Somehow, you have to somehow have a conviction deep within that you can get free of existence. You have to have that conviction. If you have that conviction, then you can do it. You can listen to this, you can hear it, and you can get it. If you don't have that conviction, you can't do it. You cannot. Because literally, by outing existence, you know, I'm outing existence entirely because it's not what you really want. But if you don't think there's an alternative, if you don't think that you can get free of it, you cannot stand to have it outed like this. You cannot. Because you think you have to learn to love existence. You think you have to learn to love existence. Therefore, you cannot look at it the way it really is. You cannot directly see it's nothing but the manufacturing of death. That's all it is. In a vain, futile quest to try to get leverage over the Prime Creator and get the Prime Creator to change reality, because we can't change it. Prime Creator can't change it either. But we don't realize that yet. We're hoping that this plan will work, and it won't. But if you have this some deeply held conviction at the deepest level, you know, but you're still aware of it, vaguely aware of it, it's a, you know, intuitive gut thing that you know what, you feel like there is a way to escape existence. Existence should be escaped. We should free ourselves from it. And in freeing ourselves from it, we're going to experience something infinitely better. If you have that deep conviction, you definitely can get it. But there is that demarcation. If you don't have it, there's no way. There's nothing I can say that's going to work. Nothing. And the truth is, we all have this deep conviction, but in some of us, it's buried so deep that it's almost like it's unconscious. It's so unconscious that it's just not accessible. You know, it just seems cannot develop escape velocity. Those, if it's buried super deep, you will continue on with another cycle of all this foolishness of manufacturing death, manufacturing loss. You'll continue on with trying to acquire as much experience with loss as possible, padding your resume so you think you're building up some power that you can then face God with this power. You know, people are afraid to face God. The way to face God is with empty hands and say, I don't have any power. And God will say, welcome home, because all the power is here. Come on in and experience it. But if you come to God with all this loss that was derived from death and suffering and sickness and misery, etc., and you come with that and you say, okay, I've got this power, and God would, you know, just say, you know, you don't have any power, there's nothing there, come on in and experience real power, and you'll feel threatened, you know, like a showdown, and you'll feel vulnerable. If you try to have a showdown with the Prime Creator, you're going to feel totally vulnerable, and it'll be terrifying. So instead of that, you keep trying to accrue more and more loss, which is what existence does. That's all that it does. Manufactures death, manufactures loss. And there's going to be a lot of loss coming up, which is why those who want to go that path feel there's a lot to gain coming up, a lot to gain. And again, we're heading into a situation where there's going to be so much loss that it's tempting. Yeah. Really, it is extremely tempting. And therein lies the problem of the times. But we knew we were coming up upon this. We knew we were coming up upon this. So that is why those who really want to make the grade and get free of this monster we call existence, have been working really, really nonstop to make the grade so they can say no to that temptation. It's like a guy, a high testosterone guy, being faced with an endless array of beautiful maidens, and they say, you know, just if you just stay looking at us a little longer, you know, we will all be yours, you know, forever. And the guy's saying, wow, you know, God, I don't know if I think maybe they're trying to trick me, but you know, maybe I want to hang in there. And of course they're trying to trick you. You know, they're the siren saying, come embrace me, come embrace me. And every, you move forward and they keep moving back, just keep moving back, you know. Before you know it, you're off the cliff. So loss is like that. It seems so attractive. Loss puts on all these attractive forms, wears beautiful dresses, you know, beautiful clothing, outfits, makeup, glamour. Oh, beautiful. Loss is so... presents itself as so beautiful to us, and we think, oh, I want to embrace that, you know, I want to embrace that, that it says, I want that, I think I want that. Loss, death, you're embracing death. You embrace existence, you're embracing death, plain and simple. No two ways about it. That's all you're embracing. You're embracing existence as a corpse. It's just a rotting corpse is all it is. That's all, if you see it truly, existence is nothing but a rotting corpse. And we keep embracing that, trying to embrace it, but it never is what we really want. And we keep seeking for more attractive forms of this, you know, trying to dress it up, make it more glamorous, turn it into a beautiful maiden or a handsome prince, you know, turn it into princess. I call it the princess principle. You either choose between the princess principle or the Passover principle. And the princess principle is, you know, all these princesses in the world say, look what an unbelievably beautiful princess I am, and I'll be yours if you just embrace me. And of course, they keep retreating time, right, and keep sucking you into time, more and more time, into the trap the tender trap, and then boom, the loss, the terrible situations occur, and you are inundated with loss, and all this loss gets registered as memories in your persona, and you're saturated with it, and then you think that you're capable now of going to the Prime Creator and saying, okay, Prime Creator, you have to make a deal. Look at how much, look, I'm saturated with loss. I've got the power of loss. That's what you think. But when you get there, your nerve fails because something's wrong. You say, oh my gosh, I don't think I can push this deal through. And then you take another incarnation. That's what happens when you, after you shed the physical body, you go into the subtler bodies, and you shed one after another. You shed these subtle energy bodies, and then finally to the point where it's the subtlest energy body, and then you are aware of reality, the Prime Creator in reality. You get close to it, and that's when you try to make your deal, and you say, okay, Prime Creator, I got the power of debt loss, and I'm going to have you lose all of your reality, all of it. I'm going to cause you to lose it all because I know how to do it, because I've lost everything, you know. So I've got this power now. I know how to do it. But I'll make you a deal, Prime Creator. You just change a little bit of reality and we'll call it even. We'll call it good. And then the Prime Creator says, can't do it. I can't change reality. No, reality can't be changed. You're out of luck. You need to repent. Give up this crazy idea of trying to change reality so you can be Prime Creator. And then, you know, you freak out. And what happens? You dive back down and start clothing yourself in energy bodies. Subtle, more and more gross, more and more gross, more and more gross, until finally, boom, you're born here into this world, physical world here, a very dense, very gross energy body. And do it all over again. Do it again. Go through all life with all its scarcity, all its vulnerability, all its desperate struggle to survive, all the disappointments, all the desperate looking for love in all the wrong places and relationships, and you get hit by all these addictions. And you know, you go up and go down, and you have hope and despair. You get chemical imbalances. You get hit by viruses. You know, you just, you make some money, you lose money, you feel, you get a house, you get it foreclosed on, you have a family, some problems, you know, in the family, some die, some survive, and at the end of the life, you find yourself in a rest home, assisted living, all drugged up, and then one day your heart stops, and then you're, you know, put in, cremated, and there you go again. Then you go through a process again of shedding your other subtle bodies gradually, and you just keep doing that over and over and over and over again, over and over and over again, and you never do get that power that you are looking for. And literally, you've wasted your time entirely. We've all wasted our time entirely. No one's different. We're all in exactly the same boat, 100% wasting our time here. There's nobody that is somehow, you know, not wasted their time here as a, you know, pursuing this. Someone who somehow is smarter than everybody else. No, it's all a waste of time for everyone. Trying to develop a power is a waste of time. We don't have any ability to develop any power. Prime Creator creates the power of reality, creates the laws, creates how it works, how it functions. Not up to us to do that. We didn't do that. We abide and function within the domain that the Prime Creator created. But it's not, we can't change it. We don't have any power to change it. Where do we get that belief we can do that? Because we just, it's a whim. We based it on nothing. There's absolutely nothing to base this on in reality. Nothing. We just said, we had this whim, like a sophomoric whim, a juvenile whim, you know, like, hey, maybe, you know, how about if we could make things different or something? I don't know. It's like a crazy whim. We cannot do that. So we cannot separate purpose and its effects. We cannot separate an idea and its effects. We cannot separate cause and its effects. That's impossible. Reality is set up that cause and effect are one. You cannot separate it. Choose an idea, you experience the effects of that idea. But that is the way reality works, and we can't change it. And yet we believe that we can, and somehow we can. So we keep thinking we don't need to change the cause of existence. Choose a new cause. Choose a new idea. Same thing. We think we can keep the same cause and change the effects and have peace. So you get these teachers and gurus, etc., who keep talking about making peace on earth. You know, we can figure out a way to forever have a totally heavenly, peaceful, wonderful earth here. Everybody happy as can be, etc., etc. Now, when you choose a new cause, there is no world as it is. Now, you wouldn't experience it as a world at all. The forms might be all familiar, be overlaid with love. You'd see only unconditional love, and you realize there is no world really, and there is no civilization or anything like that. You can't build the kingdom of heaven in existence. It's not possible. You cannot have peace on earth. That is not possible, because the purpose of this idea of trying to change reality is to manufacture death. That will continue on. Manufacture loss, trying to develop a power. Can't do it. And it brings enormous suffering and change and misery. However, you can choose a different idea, different cause, the idea of not trying to change reality, which wraps everything up in unconditional love, equally distributed. Always equally distributive, no change. You can do that. Vision of Christ has a replacement for everything we've ever imagined, has a replacement that's wrapped up in love, that it's absolutely beautiful. You can do that. But that's very different than trying to make a peaceful world or bring love into the world, as it were. That is not possible. It's a waste of time to even, what you need to go for is the vision of Christ, is to choose a different cause. The vision won't come until you choose a different cause, until you're willing to set down the idea of trying to change reality. And as long as we think we can change existence, we're not setting it down. You cannot change existence. Nobody can. Nobody can. Even God cannot change existence. Cannot. God can't change reality. God cannot separate cause and effect. And we chose this idea, that's a cause, of wanting to change reality, and that has its effects with it. Cannot separate them. Cannot. And if you can just hear this one thing, you are literally in the right place to get free of existence. Literally. Period. That's all that it takes, is that you can't do it. You stop trying to accomplish the impossible. And when you stop trying to accomplish the impossible, you see what is possible, right? And you see, choosing a different cause, a different idea is possible, very possible. That's it. And that's the only teaching that there'll ever be given out, the only true teaching in many different ways, but that's it. You're not going to get something else. Can't have your cake and eat it too, and it just has to be repeated, and somehow, I don't know how, it has to sink in. There has to be a conviction. Again, there has to be this inner conviction that you know, reality is untouched by dreams of its destruction. And how do you get that? You get it not from any teacher. You get it internally. You have an experience. The cat is sleeping over there. A lot of people are like cats. They just want to sleep all the time. All the time. They just want to sit in front of their home theater and just zone out, you know. Have the popcorn and just zone out. And, you know, whatever the whole accoutrement of the zoning out experience, whatever it takes. The inner conviction that reality is untouched by dreams of destruction has to come from within an experience. It cannot be conceptual. Cannot be conceptual. Guaranteed. I can't give anyone that experience. Nobody can. It comes from your willingness. There is somehow the grace of God knows your willingness. And if you're willing to follow through on this experience, if you're willing to follow through on it, it'll come to you. You'll have it. You will have it. Somehow you'll get a glimpse of truth. Of real truth, you know, not a state of consciousness. You'll get a glimpse of reality, and you'll say, "Oh my gosh, it can never be touched by anything. It is cannot be violated by anything, can never be changed. And there is no power that can do anything to it, cannot be intimidated. You know, and so you realize, oh, we're wasting our time, wasting our time. You get that conviction, boom, then you follow through on that conviction, and you definitely can see that what we're doing here is trying to accomplish the impossible, trying to separate cause and effect. And all this talk about creating a better world is nonsense. Nonsense. Existence will always be the way that it's always been, which is nothing but the manufacturing of death. It'll always be that. And because that's what, you know, that's what trying to change reality brings about, is you have to imagine that you can develop a power to force God to change reality, because we have no power to change it. So we think, well, if we don't have it, God must have the power, and God doesn't want to change reality, so we have to force God to change reality. And we think, when God says, no, I can't change reality, we just think that the prime creator doesn't want to, because it wants to keep us down, you know, keep us in chains, as it were. Keep us shackled to being just spirit, you know, as if, you know, how can perfect freedom be in chains or be shackled? It is not. There's no, you know, it's absolutely eternal delight. But we believe that God is, it can do it, but just won't. So we have to force God to do it. That is what we believe. That is what existence believes. That's the belief system of existence. And we come into existence, that belief system is part and parcel of the whole situation. Now, occasionally you get some renegades, some mavericks like myself, who come in and say, no, and that's not right. That belief system is not right. It's futile. It's insane. Whoa, what was that? We cannot force the prime creator to change reality. The prime creator cannot change it. It is what it is. That's what makes reality what it is. It is what it is, eternally, endlessly. It's unchangeable. The framework within which we delight in our freedom, that framework cannot be changed. And so this vain notion that somehow that prime creator is just bluffing and really can change it, but doesn't want to, because it wants to stay prime creator, doesn't want us to be greater, and that therefore we have to force the hand of the prime creator, that keeps us going with us on the steering wheel of existence, keeps us driving down that long, lonesome road, you know, and of loss, death, thinking that, you know, someday we're going to have enough power to force the prime creator's hand and we'll be prime creator. But the truth is, for those of you who are willing to listen, who'll save yourself enormous suffering just by listening and hearing this, prime creator is not bluffing. Prime creator cannot change reality. So cannot force the prime creator's hand. There's no bluff going on at all. None. We're the ones who are bluffing. So it's all a waste of time. Waste of our time. All this loss is a waste of our time. It's futile. Futile. It's been futile from the get-go. Always been futile. And don't go saying, oh yeah, well, existence used to be really nice until some crazy idea crept in. No. Remember, in order to inflict loss, there has to be something that seems that it's, you know, that's life, that's beauty, etc. And then, boom, it's wiped out. So, to say that is to miss the whole point. You know, to say, oh, everything was beautiful and blissful and happy and secure, and then some crazy principle came in and started killing everything, and oh, isn't this awful? Now, come on. That's exactly how this existence has to work. First, it has to set up all this stuff, and then, boom, kills it off. So then it can say, how else can it generate supposed evidence of some power over reality if it doesn't try to set something up that seems like a facsimile of reality and then annihilates it? And then it can go to prime creator and say, look, I have this power, I can annihilate reality, look what I've annihilated. I annihilated something that's very similar to reality. Prime creator say, what are you talking about? It's not similar to, it's not reality at all. It's symbolic imagination, imagining symbols. That's not reality. Annihilating symbols doesn't mean anything. And the prime creator just saying, come on, drop this bluff. It's ridiculous. And yet we're still saying, nah, the prime creator's bluffing. We're going to force the prime creator's hand. We just got to get a little more loss going, you know. So everybody gets into this collective hive mentality of, yeah, we got to make a big loss, inflict a big loss, a whole heap of loss. A whole mess of loss, you know, to bring it all about. And then, collectively, we together, we are powerful. Prime creator, you're just wasting your time. Come on, come on. Be wise. Listen to truth. Listen to the truth tellers. Because that's all you got here. All you have in existence is truth tellers and your internal glimpse of reality, which is number one, okay? Greater than any guru is your glimpse of reality. That is the highest, greatest asset you have, is you have the ability to glimpse reality. Why am I saying this? Because I did it. It happened for me. I glimpsed reality. And from that point, I said, wow, all I got to do is just go with this. I knew it, guaranteed. So that is number one. And then the truth tellers just reinforce this and say, yeah, go, go. We're just, truth tellers are simply physical trainers, like, you know, like workout trainers. Like, come on, work out. Every day. You get these superstars, what do they have? They have trainers, physical trainers. And the physical trainer comes, you know, 3 o'clock or whenever, they have an appointment, and they work the superstar out for 2 hours. And come on. And they say, do this. More. Come on. Work it, you know, and push them. Because, in other words, they supply the motivation and the push. Otherwise, the star would say, oh, I'm so tired. I didn't sleep last night. I got all stressed out. I'm sore, you know, making excuses. And the trainer says, no excuses. You know, you got to go for it, you know. Look at the great athletes and stars and things of the world. And inevitably, they have personal trainers. They have, you know, also like nutritionists. And they have a whole entourage that really help them stay on top. So you who have a glimpse of reality, then you have these, you know, truth tellers, those who say, come on, go for it, keep going, you can do it. That's it. That's all you got. And, you know, some are better than others, for sure. I'm just a middling. I'm nothing special at all. You get into the higher grades of truth tellers, they literally radiate the fact that reality is totally unthreatened by anything in existence. They radiate that, even in the midst. So in the midst of this turmoil and chaos and death of existence, they're totally in total delight all the time. And they're just showing you, this doesn't affect existence one bit. Those are the highest teachers. The ones who literally like embody the delight and security of existence, of reality in existence. So that you can recognize, wow, because reality is not affected by what's going on here at all. You could see it. That is the highest truth tellers. And then from there on down, there's all sorts of different gradations or whatever. It's not clearly delineated or anything like that. You just have those who have different styles of training, trainers saying, come on, go for it, motivators. Saying, go for it. It's there. It's true. Trust it. Trust the truth. Don't doubt in the dark what you saw in the light. Trust it. And then the great reassurers, just reassure us, all is well in reality. Reality is not threatened by anything. All this death existence is doing, reality is not concerned about that in the slightest bit. Whew, that's like, wow. That's the greatest. That is the greatest. And someday we should be so fortunate. But in the meantime, go. You know, go. I'm doing my best to motivate you to stay with it. If you have that inner conviction that all is well in reality, because it is. If you glimpsed it, you know what I'm talking about. All is well. There's nothing wrong with reality. Reality is not threatened in any way by anything. We don't have the power to create a power. We're not power creators. And yet we're all on this power trip. You know, talk about existence, what is it? It's a power trip. We're all on a power trip. You know, dress it up whatever way you want to dress it up. Camouflage it whatever way you want to camouflage it. It's all that it is. We're on a power trip. And death is the power trip. We're trying to get this power of destructivity, of loss, of threatening reality. We want to threaten reality. We want to threaten the Prime Creator with destruction of reality so that Prime Creator will then agree to change reality so that we can be Prime Creators. See, we that's what we want. Let's just be completely, blatantly obvious about it. That's what we want. We want the Prime Creator to make us Prime Creator. Okay, that's it. And so we think we have to threaten the Prime Creator with destruction because the Prime Creator won't do it on its own. So we have to threaten with destruction. So we're trying to manufacture this power of destruction. And so, you know, we keep working at it, feverishly working at it on the subtle levels. We're all, you know, working at it so strong, and we're working for this planetary sacrifice on this planet here. And of course, we're bumblers and fumblers, and so everything, you know, keeps getting in the way of everything else, and it's like a Keystone Cops movie, a French farce, you know. Just we can't even do destruction right, but we certainly try, and it's hard to delineate exactly how it will play out because of this unintended obstruction. We keep getting in our own way. We're trying to sacrifice everything, and we keep getting in our way, and so, but our purpose is that. It's the purpose of existence, and it certainly will play out in some fashion. It will play out in some fashion. The intensity, the speed of it, etc., etc., you know, it's hard to say. The way I see it, it'll be sudden. A lot of it will be very sudden, breathtakingly fast. But on the level that we're focused on the external level, that seems impossible. You know, it seems like things cannot go that fast. On the subtle levels, definitely, it can go very fast. And the question is, what kind of time lag will there be between the subtle and the physical here, the non-subtle, as it were, the less subtle? Will it play out here, boom, you know, really fast, or will it kind of be a slow rolling type of thing, rolling blackout, as it were? I believe it'll be fast, but you know, I could be wrong on that. In any event, whether it's fast or slow or whatever, it doesn't matter, does it? Because the truth is, you want to escape it. You want to repent, means you choose a new idea, choose a new cause, different cause. And therefore, you escape the effects of the other cause that you didn't want by choosing a new cause. It is so completely easy to understand. If you don't like the effects of one cause, then choose a different cause, and you will escape the effects of that other cause, guaranteed. But no, we keep thinking, nah, we don't want reality to work like that anymore. We don't want reality to work the way that it used to work, because we want it to work in a different way. We want it to work to make us Prime Creator. So we don't trust that reality works the way that it's always worked, which would work completely to our benefit, because we could choose a different cause. We would escape the effects of this cause, other cause. We would. And yet we think, no, because that would mean that reality hasn't been changed, and we don't want to believe that. We want to believe a reality has been changed or can be changed. So we're just going to distrust it. We're going to refuse to take the one step that would save us like that, easily, gently, beautifully. We refuse to do it because we're more into bluffing God and saying, God, you have to change reality. So if we accepted that, we'd be so happy, and we'd say, oh, why would we want to change reality? It's perfect. So we can refuse to do that. We refuse. Which is why we have so much trouble just understanding what's being said here, is because, again, the game would be up at that point. Because we'd say, oh my gosh, I trusted reality. And I trusted it, meaning I don't think it can be changed. I don't think I can change it. So let it work for me. Let it work for me. Let me choose a different cause, and I'll escape the effects of that other cause. And when it works, we say, oh my gosh, I haven't affected reality in the slightest bit. It still works perfectly. And then we'll think, uh-oh, all this loss I've accumulated it hasn't had any effect on reality whatsoever. And then you'll say, oh man, maybe I wasted all my time, maybe it's futile, you see? And then the game would be up, just like that. But the game's already up. The game's always been up, because it never had a chance to work in the first place. And again, to keep reiterating all of this, we wanted the Prime Creator to make us Prime Creator. See what it's like. Prime Creator said, I can't do that. And then we thought that the Prime Creator just didn't want to do it. In other words, in order to entertain this idea, to believe it's possible, we had to believe the Prime Creator just doesn't want to do it, because the Prime Creator is somehow a power mad and wants to stay in number top position, doesn't want us to be top position, so to speak. Therefore, we believe that we can force the Prime Creator's hand. It can do it. Prime Creator can do it, just doesn't want to. That's our belief, and that's a false belief. It's a mistaken belief. It all boils down to that. Is Prime Creator refusing to change reality because it can't be changed, or because it doesn't want to change it? That is the question, right? And if you've seen a glimpse of reality, you realize it can't be changed. So the game's up at that point, and then you just need to kind of align yourself with this truth, which can take quite a bit of effort and time. But you know, people generally, we don't want to go too fast. We're kind of, you know, worried about going too fast. So you know, it can play out as fast or slow as you want. And so we're just in this game with the Prime Creator, as it was, and we keep saying, no, the Prime Creator invented this game because the Prime Creator was bored or something, some kind of nonsense. I've heard so much spiritual nonsense spoken, so much, from spiritual teachers of all different types. What nonsense to say that God created this whole game just because God wanted, was interested, was bored, or wanted to play this game. Nonsense. God would be a complete sadist if that were the case. Be a maniac, maniacal sadist to put us through all this. God had nothing to do with this. We were the ones who went to God and said, God, we want you to make us Prime Creator on a whim. And God said, I can't do it. Can't do it. It's impossible. Because reality is all one. We are it already. There's nothing to change. We're already everything. We already have everything. You already are one. You know, it's not like you're being deprived of anything at all. But there has to be the principle of that oneness, of that perfect sharing, of that perfect freedom. And the Prime Creator says, that comes from me. That comes from what I am. I shared what I am with all that is. It's all shared, already shared. And to change anything means it would not be perfectly shared anymore. So it's impossible. Can't do it. And we then decided, well, let's see if we can force the Prime Creator's hand. You know, maybe Prime Creator's just bluffing and just doesn't want to. So then we entertain. Now then we get into building up loss, trying to build up this power to threaten the Prime Creator. Super cut, super obvious, super cut and dried. And again, that's all there is to it. And it just boils down to us, you know, just kind of, it's hard to prove anything, right? Because we think we can change reality, or we think the Prime Creator's bluffing. So no matter what evidence is presented here or anywhere, we can still say, well, I think you're just bluffing. You know, Prime Creator really can be forced to change reality. You know, how can you prove otherwise? I mean, what constitutes proof? Direct experience. Glimpsing reality. To be fair, you need to at least say, well, let me take a look at reality and let me just be sure Prime Creator's bluffing. And that's what happened with me. And what I saw and felt and knew was that, no, it's not, no bluff. Can't change it. He cannot change reality. It cannot be changed. It's not, Prime Creator's not bluffing. But other than a direct experience, I don't think there's any way. There really isn't. Except there is a deep intuition within us that knows this to be true. But we can obscure this and deny it. So a direct experience is the most powerful situation. And if you do have that, then you've got it. You've already got it. You know the truth. And then it's just a matter of accepting it, which takes a while. Because it takes a while to work all this through to the point where you see, I see, it's so very simple what took place. It's not all complex. We're baffled by the complexity of this vast scenario, all this loss, all this death. We're kind of baffled by it. And we keep thinking that, you know, we can find something we want here. Or we find something we really want. And it just takes a while to wind down. It's like turning off a fan that's been going super fast. At the lumberyard, there's this big, huge bandsaw, and it goes so fast, the revolutions. You know, they turn it off once they've done their cuts, and that thing just keeps going and going and going and going and going for a long time before it finally stops. The momentum, you know. But once you turn it off, you know it's eventually going to stop. Once you get a glimpse of reality, essentially you've turned the switch off on that bandsaw of existence, a bandsaw of death, the cycles of death. You've turned the switch off, and it's just slowing down, gradually slowing down, gradually slowing down, till finally it stops like that. Once you see reality, you know the game's up. You know it. Game is up. You've seen it. Say, ah. Bluff. This bluff is never gonna work. I waste the time. So you realize you don't want to keep wasting time. You don't want to keep dying, suffering, all this stuff. No way. It's not what we really want. You know, we want to get back to that incredible delight of reality. That is just simply unimaginably great and satisfying to us. We want to get back to that ASAP. So when we see that this whole bluff isn't going to work, oh boy, we say, wow. I got to drop this cause then. Get free of these effects, I got to drop the cause. And we try and align with that. Do our best to align with that. Not always easy. It's simple, but not always easy, because in this world, everyone's trying to align with loss, you know, greater loss. How can we get the power? You know, I got the power. You know, people are saying, yeah, I got to find the power. Everybody's looking for the power, looking for some, that power, you know, what is it? It's the power of death is what they're looking for. But we don't, again, we have no capability to create any power, none. It's nothing, so it's nothing. Death is nothing. Never has been anything. It's just a silly game of imagination we're playing. But our mind, bringing about this imagination, this hypothetical scenario, which is imaginary, the mind is very, you know, mind is very powerful. It just cannot create a power. See, it's a difference, right? Mind is, you know, what it all powerful in what it does in its functioning. It can, you know, wow. It literally produces experiencing for us spontaneously. You know, there's no end to the mind's ability to produce experiencing for us, the effects of a cause. But it has no power to create a power. See, there you go. There is the difference. Ah, a little bird just came down. Came down to say hello. Okay, so we are awed by the power of existence, by this massive masquerade of death. This great production plant. Uh-oh, the cat sees the bird. Hey! Okay. What can I throw? Is it okay? Yeah. There you go. Okay. The bird. Wow. Bird didn't see the cat. Bird did not see the cat. Wow. Cat was sneaking up on it there. Okay. Sorry, cat. Now the cat's looking at me like, why did you make that noise? Why did you make that noise? So, you know, I'm like that. We are like the bird, okay? We have the freedom. We can fly away. The cat is like this sacrificial scenario that is coming on the world. And the cat is sneaking up on us, you know? And there's somebody has to be there, bam, 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 you know, and to alert the bird, you know, fly away, fly away. Don't get caught in this trap. That's all that we're doing here, just alerting you to what's coming. And the bird, you know, is quick, and the bird got it. When I finally caused enough commotion, the bird, pew, you know, and now the cat is just kind of sitting there, just looking around like, real cool, like, you know, saying, I was never after any bird in the first place. Nah. I just kind of wanted to stretch and move around a little bit, and I'm totally happy. You know, cats are, they never want to admit that they were ever thwarted in anything. No, I just came here to smell the flowers. No, I just wanted to sit here for a while. So he's playing it cool type of thing. Existence will play it cool. For those who escape the sacrificial trap, existence will say, I was never trying to sacrifice you in the first place. No, I had no interest in that. That's all. So existence will play it cool, but don't be fooled by that. Don't be fooled. Existence is literally like a cat. You know, it's very sneaky. Pretends that it's not interested. I'm not interested in sacrifice at all. No way. I just want to relax and be happy and all this stuff. But then when the opportunity comes, the cat is, you know, very quietly sneaking up, you know, pow! Like that. And that's what we got on the subtle level. The subtle level is sneaking up on us right now. Sneaking up on us. Very stealthily. And, you know, not few can see this. I can see it. There are others that can see it. Because we're, you know, born sensitives, we're aware of the subtle realm, and have stayed in tune with that, and don't discount it, understand how it works, realize that this physical realm are just a patsy for the subtle realms. This physical realm is manufactured to be a patsy. Don't you see that? Loss needs a patsy. Death needs a patsy. It's a setup. It's a setup. Physical realm is a setup. It's nothing but a setup. It's meant to be wiped out. It's meant to be wiped out. And, you know, I look at the people here, and everybody, again, is just acting like, I'm so happy. I've got my home theater. I'm just chilling. Everything's cool. Got all my accoutrements. Got my drugs, I've got my alcohol, I've got my coffee and energy drinks, I've got my food, I've got my partner, you know, and life is great, you know, what more could we want? And you just realize they're just patsies. Just patsies. They're literally preparing themselves for annihilation, as it were, death. And, you know, everyone's always looked at me and said, wow, you know, he's weird. Well, why? He's not like us. Well, you know, he's not a patsy, you know. But we're supposed to be patsies here. Why are you not this way, you know? And they have no idea that there's a role of truth tellers, whistleblowers, motivators, spiritual trainers. That there is this principle of God's grace that come into this world and boom, you know, frighten the birds, scare the birds, startle the birds. The bird, you know, gets free of this. And if you don't not aware of that, then you say, oh, this person's weird, you know, they can't figure out why. Not a patsy. Why? We're all supposed to be patsies, aren't we? That's what the physical realm is for. It's supposed to be cannon fodder for the subtler realms. There are many entities that function in the subtle realms. Subtle realms, intensely functioning, and those... that functionality, call it, you know, entities, whatever you want. The psychic vampires, etheric vampires, you can name all sorts of, you know, terms about, you know, about how it works. But bottom line is, the subtler realm, you know, comes in and feasts on this gross realm, feasts on it, you know, destroys it, annihilates it, feasts on it. To the etheric, to these subtler realms, you know, Oh my gosh, it's like a banquet table laid out here. And where all the food? Where the food? Where the patsies? All these courses, and they have like 7-course meal all set up for them. You know, one course, they finish that, and then a second course, and a third, and a fourth, and they polish off with dessert, and wow, they feel, you know, great. Wow, look at all this loss that we managed to generate. And then celebration, they all celebrate, and they say, this is fabulous. Now we got the power, right? At least they think they do. And someone say, yeah, but what about those ones that escaped it? You know, they go, ah, no. We were never after them in the first place. We got exactly what we were aiming for, you know. Like the cat, you know. Where did the cat go? Just, I don't know. Cat will go somewhere else and do it again. Wait for the bird again. So the subtle level just kind of waits until the gross level here is all built up. The meal is prepared. The banquet table is prepared. 7 billion people here, all zoned out, all kind of in this dazed, goofy zombie state. You know, really, you got 7 billion zombies on this planet right now. Really. And, you know, the subtle levels are just waiting for that feast to begin and pounce on it, you know. And they've got a lot of operatives here who are like puppets, and those puppets will do their, you know, puppet dance here. And the people of this world have no awareness. They're like incoherent zombies. And they think, hey, this is great. It's like cattle, you know, being fed all this corn, you know. And if the cattle says, wow, this is fabulous. I'm getting all this corn. I'm in this stall. And all I do all day is eat this corn. And the cow says, man, this is nirvana, you know. This is just great. And the cow, you know, gets all fat and happy. And then one day, you know, cows get loaded onto the cattle cars. The next thing you know, they're hanging in a butcher shop. So that's how it works, you know. That's an analogy. You know, the cattle are to, you know, the ranchers and the processors, etc., as we are to the subtle level, okay? As the physical world is to the subtle worlds. So the subtle worlds, you know, are just looking at us like, you know, food, cattle, to generate loss, to generate the power of death, as it were, to augment, you know, this effort to create a power. Again, the mind is all powerful to generate experiences for us, including even imaginary experiences, hypothetical experiences, which what existence is. It's hypothetical. It's not a real experience, it's a hypothetical. But it's all powerful to do that, and so simply can do it seamlessly and beautifully and intricately and exactly what is needed. The mind presents exactly what is needed for the cause, for the idea, for what we want to experience. But it has no power to create a power. It has no power to create a power. None. And yet that's what we're trying to do. We ask the mind to create a power. It can't do it. All it can do is generate infinite loss, infinite death, which is what it's doing, which is what this idea, this cause of wanting to change reality, you know, that's, it's always generated all this loss. You know, first it sets the table, you know, and there's 7 billion people on this planet thinking life is pretty good. You know, I mean, hey, we can really dress up. You know, we got a lot of, everyone's got some pretty neat clothes, and everybody got all, I mean, shoes. You go down the shoe store, there's like thousands of shoes, you know, you can just, whoo, you know, unbelievable, right? They used to just go to these, you know, Nordstrom's Rack or something. There's like, you know, hundreds and hundreds of new shoes. You've never seen these fashions. It goes on and on. And if you're a woman, you got even more. My gosh. And constantly changing, you know, and you got shoes, you got clothes, you got ways to present yourself in so many different ways, and jewelry, endless jewelry and embellishments, accessories, endless accessories, my gosh, purses, you know, you got all of that, and then you got all of these movies and entertainment and diversions of every kind. You gotta, if you wanna, you know, see whatever you wanna see, you see some fools doing something, you can see it, right? You know, You can see somebody eating anything, you know. If you want to, you can see some geek eating toilet paper or something. I mean, anything you want, you can see it now. You can see people dying. See on, you know, the news, whatever. The correspondence from the wars. There's wars. They're like, go over there and everybody's, you know, taking video of all these, this, you know, wars and people killing each other and doing all these atrocities. And they, you know, show them, make them available to everybody. You can watch that if you want. You can watch anything. Pornography, all different kinds of depravity. Every kind of depravity you can possibly imagine is available to anybody who wants to watch it. All the stuff, and we all think, oh, we're so fortunate in these days. You know, so fortunate. No, we're just cattle being fattened up on corn. That's it. Because first the table has to be set, and then you got to have all these fat fools. Then the cat pounces. And when the cat pounces, it pounces fast, okay? That's why I saw the cat and I jumped up, you know, and scared the bird off. Because the cat gets real close, doesn't move, right? And you think, oh, first the cat moves real slowly, then gets in position, and then it stops. And you think, oh, okay, nothing's happening. And then, pow! The cat, you know, pounces like that, which is why I'm saying, the way I see the future is this sudden collapse. Sudden bad situation arrives suddenly with breathtaking speed, and you, the bird, has gotta fly away out. And this one did it. God, for you can do it. You got the wings to do it. You got the speed to do it. You have it. But don't get trapped in it, because it's like paralyzed. It's immobilizing. You'd be immobilized. And the feast, of course, is one of brutality, suffering. They don't want us just to die like that. They want us to go through every kind of suffering possible before we die. They want us to see all our friends and loved ones go through all the suffering before they die too. They want us all to experience this horrible train wreck, you know, and see everything just, you know, brutally stripped away from us. They want us to die the death of a thousand cuts, as it were. And that's what they've set up. And the banquet table has been set here, you know. We're all fat, dumb. It's hard not to be. I mean, you want a beer, you can go down and, you know, if you want to, you know, you can probably find thousands of different varieties of beer. If you look on the internet, you can probably find a lot more. You can literally order any beer you want in the world. You can probably buy it online and have it shipped to you, really. I mean, you literally, the world has become our marketplace. The entire world is our marketplace. I can get anything. You can get anything in the world. Everything is for sale now. You know, you can buy something from New Guinea, you know, or wherever. Some entrepreneur is there and you want to buy it, you know, they'll ship it to you. DHL or FedEx or UPS, somehow they'll get it to you, and you can buy anything now. So you think, wow, the world is my oyster. This is great. This is like heaven. It's nirvana. It's exactly what I wanted. Fools. That's the fattening up part. That is dropping your guard part. You're so busy chasing after what you think you want that you don't even see what's going on the subtle levels. Okay. And, you know, you can get any fashion you want. Literally, you can order it from Paris if you want. Anybody can now. It's not the province of aristocracy anymore. It used to be the aristocracy could do that. I mean, people would fly in food. I know. A good friend of an acquaintance used to own a restaurant in a certain country, and they would literally fly in food from Spain. Fly in food from Spain, you know. Fly it in. Whatever they wanted. Get it flown to them. Flown into the restaurant. And then serve, you know, for the patrons of the restaurant. But we can, aristocracy used to fly in whatever they wanted. Fresh food, whatever. They'd fly it in. They'd boat it in. They'd find it, train it in. You know, they had ways to get whatever they wanted. Now, we can all do that. So we're like aristocracy now. Everybody. Just have a credit card. And, PayPal or something, and you can pretty much get anything you want. That's what people are doing. So they think, wow, we're kings and queens. We're princes and princesses now. You know, no more are we suffering from scarcity. We can get anything we want. That's like the cow saying, wow, no longer do I have to go out and forage in the field for the alfalfa and grass and spend all day going up and down hills and looking for scrub grass and all this stuff and worrying about ticks and flies and all this brambles and all this, you know, coyotes and whatever and all these mountain lions. Wow, now I'm in this nice barn and I have a nice stall and there's this endless corn is just pouring out for me. And all I gotta do is just eat it. This is fantastic. I love it. I love it. And just boom, bloat right up. Then the rancher says, wow, looks like that cow is ready for the market. Cow's like, huh? 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 And pushed on the cow car. And the cow starts freaking out and panicking. Whoa, what's going on? I know what's going on. I know what's going on. Goes into this just cold death spiral, like, you know, total adrenaline and all this stuff, which is why, you know, when the cattle are slaughtered and all these animals are slaughtered, their meat is full of this, you know, intense dread of death and being slaughtered, etc. They're just, all the hormones and everything they've got in their system is like kablam, you know, in their blood, saturating all the meat and everything. It's terrible to eat that stuff. It literally helps turn you into a zombie. You get dumbed down. You get dumbed down. Meat really dumbs you down a lot. I'm a vegetarian. It's important. Because eating meat will really keep you dumbed down. Very much so. Because the whole process that these animals go through, you know, is really, you're taking that into your system. And that affects you, dumbs you down too. You kind of think, hey, this is going to happen to me, you know, it prepares you in some way. So being a vegetarian is a good idea, as a matter of fact. Very good idea. It helps you see the subtle situation. It really does. Really does. You don't feel like a victim anymore, like a dumb cow. Who is so flooded with all this, these hormones and fear and confusion, etc., that don't know what's going on. You keep eating that stuff, that meat that's got all that within it. And forget about this organic thing, too, because those animals are still slaughtered, you know, same way. Sure, they're brought up on no steroids and hormones, whatever, and they're supposed to be humanely treated, etc., but they're still slaughtered, and all that is still the all those chemicals that are released in the panic and about to be slaughtered and all this kind of stuff is still there. You get that, you're still getting that, still being dumbed down into that confusion and panic and fear of death, etc. So you're not able to really, you know, see the subtle stuff that's going on, see the cat sneaking up on you, as it were. Not nearly as well. Not nearly as well. You see, people eat a lot of beef. They look like, they act like cows, basically. And not judging, just warning, saying, you know, being a vegetarian is a very good thing. Most encouragers and reassurers and spiritual trainers in the world advise that very strongly, very strongly. Same thing, stay away from the energy drinks, stay away from any caffeine, anything that stimulates you. Bad news, really bad news. Dumbs you down, it really dumbs you down. You're not able to. It kind of, drugs are very bad, very bad. Stay away from it at all costs. The unintended consequences of those are really nasty. Sometimes drugs enable you to see the subtle stuff, but it opens it up in such a way that it causes an even worse shutdown, like a rebound effect. It overwhelms you. You get overwhelmed, and then your mind gets freaked out, and you say, how can I deal with all this? And your mind gets overactive, or you go from one drug that shows you the subtle stuff to another which shuts it off, you know. Start drinking a whole bunch of alcohol to counteract the effects, and you end up bouncing back and get on all my medications, and it's a horrible road. You can't do it that way. You can't do it that way. You cannot do it that way. You can't do it with drugs. You can't do it with stimulants. You can do it. You do it by leading a clean life and spending lots of time in clarification of seeing beneath the surface. That's how you do it. There's no shortcut to it. Don't be fooled by those shortcuts. A lot of people, I mean, I grew up in the generation of the drug generation. And so many, 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 many people thought that they were going to get it through drugs. And because drugs opened up all the subtle stuff. And they couldn't process it. They couldn't put it in context. Bad news. And none of them made it. You know, just didn't make it. Just could not put it in context at all. So just caused all sorts of problems. All sorts of problems. Terrible, terrible situation. And then they got into denial of this thing. Oh, no, it was great for me. And therefore, they have this permissive attitude to their children, saying, oh, yeah, there's no problem. Drugs, look how good I turned out, you know. Nonsense. They failed. I mean, the record of failure for my generation is horrible. Horrible. And subsequent generations, too, think, hey, it's no big deal, you know, look. Mom and Dad, you know, said that they turned out great. No, they didn't. So many died. So many OD'd. So many wrecks, human wrecks. So many just kept doubling down. So many got on side trips. And, you know, never got out of it. Horrible. So you have to put the subtle realm into proper context. The way you do that is you have the experience of reality. Then you can put it all in the right context. Otherwise, if you just open up the subtle levels through drugs or through some meditation practices or you raise the kundalini, whatever, tantra, all this nonsense, you do that, you are asking for the worst kind of trouble. First, you have to get a glimpse of reality. Jesus said, seek the kingdom of heaven first and everything else will be added unto you. You have to have a glimpse of reality first. Then you can literally put everything else into the right context, which is what I've been able to do. Do it the right way. But so many others did it the wrong way, and now they're up a creek without a paddle. They realize there's all the subtle stuff. They can't put it in context. Can't put it in context. It's a tragedy, you know? I told people, you know, drugs are not the way. But at that time, nobody would listen, you know? You had to be hip. You had to go along with the Beatles, you know? Hey, the Beatles are doing drugs. Look how creative they are. Look how subtle they are. Isn't that great, you know? And we want to be like the Beatles. We want to be like the idols, these musicians. Musicians were the ones who really pushed the whole drug culture on my generation. Bunch of idiots. Bunch of know-nothings. Bunch of fools. You know, really, tell you the truth. And someday you'll realize that. I know people hate to hear that because they still are worshiping the idol of all these great, so-called great musicians. Second, something big is coming through here. Fire truck with its sirens, lights flashing, all this kind of stuff. Bunch of fire trucks all over the place the last couple days. Wow. Do I smell smoke? I don't know. Anyway, they got it under control, right? The firemen are there. They know what they're doing. I tell you, they really do. My generation still worships these guys and gals, you know, who legitimized the whole drug culture for us and said, you know what, you can be like us. Look how famous we are. Look how popular we are. Look, we have everything. We're royalty. We're aristocracy. You can have it too. And how do we get it? How do we get so creative? How do we get so cool? Through drugs. Of course, drugs make you seem real creative because they open up subtler energy, awareness of subtler energy. Some of them. Alcohol, not really. That just alcohol knocks out your verbal side of your brain, and so you become, you can perform really well. Like George Jones used to drink like a fish, and he could sing unbelievably well. Alcohol didn't affect his singing at all. It knocked out his stage fright. It knocked out his verbal, conceptual, that part of his brain. And then he just said, well, I can sing. I can sing great. So let me just sing. And a lot of entertainers use alcohol, use various drugs that help them sing better. But, you know, they paid a fearsome price for that. But the other psychotropic drugs and all that stuff opens up awareness of subtler energy fields. And then you can get super creative. Or at least you're relatively so to those who are not using drugs or are not so aware of the subtle levels through other means, through dedication, etc. And then, so we thought, hey, you know, all we need to do is take these pills, take this drugs, whatever, and we can be as creative as the Beatles, you know. We can do this music too. Get your guitar and, you know, form a band, etc., etc. Everybody, and they felt we can tune into it better. We can tune into these, where these people are coming from. We used to call it, yeah, I can see where they're coming from. In other words, everybody gets high, they can see where these performers, entertainers are coming from, because the performers are all high too, like crazy. And we thought, hey, you know, we're getting enlightened. No, we're not. We're just seeing subtler energy. That's not got nothing to do with getting enlightened. Nothing. Especially not being able to put it in the right context. We're actually getting worse. It's worse. What happened was we had false hope peddled to us under the guise of being cool and getting more creative, and it made things worse for us. Not better. Worse. We regressed because we ended up thinking that we were getting enlightened without the right context at all, and wasting our time because we were not getting enlightened at all. That's not the way. That is not the way. And what fools my generation was, and the subsequent generations, or they're just, you know, they're encouraged to be fools. You know, we were fools, and our, you know, my parents' generation warned us, and especially my grandparents. You know, they said, "Hey, you guys are fools. You're idiots. You're doing the wrong way." You know, and thank God some of them spoke up. Really, thank God for the old timers. Because, you know, I heard that, you know. The peer pressure was insane during that time, totally insane. And the older people spoke up and said, hey, you guys are, you know, you're going down the devil's path for sure. And we thought, you're a bunch of old fogey crazy, you don't know nothing. You know, we're aware of all this subtle stuff and energy, and we're high, and we're seeing this stuff, and we're super creative, and we're going to change the world, you know, and you guys are just a bunch of, you know, moralistic prudes, a bunch of backcountry hicks, you don't know nothing, you're superstitious, you know, a bunch of religious zealots. And we just completely trashed the older generation, completely trashed them. They turned out to be right. We turned out to be wrong, speaking generationally. I heard these older people. I said, hey, wait a minute, you know, they got something to say. What are they saying? Let me listen. I want to see the whole picture, not just, you know, a small part of it. Let's listen to all sides before we, you know, go crazy here on something. Let's what's being said. Listen to the gurus. Let's say, what are they saying? They're saying that's not the way. Come on. Although some gurus kind of thought it was kind of funny, silly, and, you know, they kind of like Well, they kind of liked the attention that the Westerners gave them. All these drug act, high druggies, go over to India and wow, they're smoking ganja over there and getting down with all the groove of the subtle realms, and maybe some of the gurus kind of like the attention, thinking, yeah, they're getting it, they're getting it, they're getting it. Fools, the real teachers have said, hey, no way. Drop it. Drop all that stuff. Live a clean life. Super clean life. Be a vegetarian. No stimulants, no drugs. That has got to be ironclad. Otherwise, you're going to go down a very bad path. And that's what happened. And, horrible. Really. What my generation went through, absolutely horrible. We're not recommended for anyone. Because you get into those subtle levels and you can't sort it out. You cannot. And I was just supremely fortunate that I had the willingness to dedicate myself to putting it in right, all in right context, that I got that experience, a glimpse of reality. Not through drugs, didn't get it through drugs, no. I got it because I was determined to do the right thing and do what I came here to do. And I said, I got to stay true to that. Got to stay true to it. And I got the glimpse, and from that point, I was able to just work nonstop work dedication to put everything in the right context. So now, I'm not bothered. But others are still just flailing, flailing around, and just they basically, just drink, 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 drink. Try to just kill the anxiety. So much anxiety medications. So many people are on anti-anxiety medications. About one in three people, antidepressants. At least one in ten. All that stuff is designed to. It comes about because of accessing subtler energy patterns and not being able to put it in the right context. That's why. That is why. And so, I mean, three curses to all those bands and all those people who made this seem so cool and peddled all this stuff. Beatles are one of them. And there's lots more, not just the Beatles. There's many, but they were the bellwether, of it all. They got the girls, to go along with it. And then when the girls go along with it, the guys basically have no choice. I said, nah, forget it. Became an outcast, severe. Because all the cool people, the beautiful women, of course, were all into that. And then, if you wanted to be popular or cool, you had to go along with the whole Beatle mania and all of that stuff. Went along with it. They pulled along with it. You had to go along with it, or else you were out of it. You're really out of it. You're nobody. You were sort of an ostracized from your own generation, is what happened. So for me, I said, "Say, what the heck's going on here?" And but it was overwhelming, really. Could not buck that tide. It was a tide. It was really a tide, like an oceanic tide. And it was disastrous. But the subtle, all the subtle stuff can be put in the right context, which is to say it's all equally futile. So why even worry about it? Why even worry about subtle energy patterns? Who cares? I don't care. I don't care about any energy patterns at all. Not looking or seeking for some kind of subtle experience. Looking to choose a new cause, which then I know will result in unconditional love, this overlay effect. I'm aware that's what it'll result in. That's all I'm looking for. So, not trying to be, super artistic. I had to give that up. Where I worked hard at that, trying to be, trying to harness the subtle energy patterns and all this stuff. I tried to harness it, you know, to present it to the world and that kind of stuff. We all got caught up in that, my generation. And I took it really, really far as did some amazing stuff that was just unbelievable, mind-blowing. With video feedback and all sorts of, I developed all sorts of ways, and I was able to make images that were so incredibly subtle that it was just like you literally were looking into the subtle realm, subtle realms, literally. Fantastically beautiful. But I threw it all away, don't have any of that. Because it had no context and would only lead people astray. We don't need more creativity in the world at all. We need right context in the world. And all these creative geniuses, you know, no matter what they do, they can't put it in right context at all. So they're hurting things. Jesus didn't say, go out and be a great artist. No. He said, seek the kingdom of heaven. So creativity is not where it's at. I mean, gosh, I can personally vouch for that. All the music I created in the creative, like, jam sessions that we did, that just, you know, was unbelievable. What we could, we're finding, we're pulling in all this stuff never even heard before. And same with the art and the visuals and the graphics and all the graphics, the work with After Effects and the Photoshop and Adobe Premiere and all the video and the feed. I set up a feedback system with multiple cameras and monitors and had this unbelievable organic etheric forms of energy producing all these incredible patterns, you know, just mind-blowing stuff. And you add putting music to that and everything, and you think, wow, I'm really tripping, you know. And then you add drugs to that, and you think, wow, I'm really, this is far out, I'm into another realm altogether. Again, no context at all. You're lost. You're lost, and it'll mess you up big time. Mess you up big time. So I try to make these videos more and more simple, more and more basic. Of course I could put on an extravaganza. Totally. Totally. I could do it as well as anybody. But for one thing, my eyes are going out on me. And if I did that, they'd really go. So, and another, two, it's not the right thing to do. It's not the right thing to do. Throwing some cheap special effects up just for variety is not a big deal. That's not a problem. Boosting the gain, you know, boosting the brightness, boosting the gain, dropping the gain, you know, whatever, like that. Doesn't matter. That's baby play. That's nothing. So I try to de-emphasize the special effects more and more and more. Get away from that more and more and more. De-emphasize the music more and more and more. Because what we're talking about here is super important. And we're talking about right context. We're talking about right context. How do you get free of all this incredible swamp of the subtle energy? It's a nightmare. It is a nightmare. You get into that and you get over your head and you can't find yourself. Oh boy. You really regret it. So all these cool people, you know what? They're cool fools. They're cool fools. I promise you that. Don't go down that direction. They're fools. I don't care how cool they think they are. And I don't care how cool their partner is, you know. Because I'm telling you, in my generation, the women of my generation could... they could look really cool. They knew how to be super cool. I mean, unbelievable how cool they were able to make themselves look. Just wow. This is tough. You know, their clothes, I mean, it's unbelievable. They're all crocheted flowers, you know, and super elaborate handiwork. And they made themselves look like, you know, the earth mothers on steroids, like subtle earth mothers. Super talented at that. Not just your, you know, regular Earth Mother, but some kind of goddess Earth Mother in a higher realm. They made themselves look like they're from a higher realm, really. They're fabulously clever at that. And so we'd see that and say, oh my gosh, you know. And we'd see them and they'd hook up with their boyfriends. Their boyfriends were some musicians or someone who was pumping out this creative stuff, you know. And we'd say, wow, I want to be that cool, you know. I want to be cool too. Look what that gets you. You get this goddess, this earth mother, subtle earth mother who's just incredible. So they're very, very talented at that. And so when faced with that, you know, we said, wow, if we're super creative, we'll get to hook up with that subtle earth goddess too. All a scam, all to get you into that subtle stuff with no context, where you get lost and you become a broken soul, as it were. Really, you get into drugs big time to try to be super creative. You get into bad lifestyles. You get into chasing materiality to keep that earth, that subtle earth mother looking, you know, subtle. Because the subtlety starts to wear off, the bloom goes off the rose, right? Sure it does. But wow, what flowers we were presented with during those times. Beautiful flowers, you know. Flower children. We were the flower children generation. And the women of that generation were big time into flower power and knew how to present themselves that way. Geniuses at it. You know, of course we got hooked. They're like super genius hookers to hook us into the subtle realms so that then we got lost and screwed up our spiritual path is what it did. But I was I was pretty, how would you put it, the attitude. The Baba, the attitude was, I had another gear. Like, I said, well, yeah, this is what I think I want, but is it what I really want? I don't think so. I don't think so. So there's this kind of conflict going on. So I never really, you know, always kind of on the fringes, saying, well, I'm not sure. I don't think what I think I want is going to really satisfy me. It's not going to be what I really want. And there's this like doubt, you know, had this very helpful, healthy doubt about it. That's not to say that, you know, that there's conflict, there's a terrible conflict. And I use the word hookers because that's exactly what it was. We were getting hooked into something that was very bad for us, a side trip. We get lost in the subtle realm. What happens? It makes you patsies. On this physical realm, you turn into a patsy. You end up aiding and abetting the subtle realms to set up this whole sacrificial situation is what happens. So it's a very, very wicked thing to do. And it happened. Absolutely did happen. 100%. 100%. And so, you know, generation got hooked into this. And then the preceding generations got hooked in demon stuff even worse. Where instead of the beautiful, subtle stuff, they got more and more gross, subtle. Hooked into that more and more. There's still a lot of hooking into subtle stuff like the fractals and all this kind of stuff. Again, it's nothing. It's not what you really want. It'll never be what you really want. It's just a way to kind of spellbind you. As you, here on the physical level, you get corn-fed, fattened up for to be sacrificed. That's all there really is. It's not going towards enlightenment at all. And we had all these flower children, my gosh. Pied Pipers, you know, these beautiful people. You know, in their buckskin, you know, embroidered buckskin clothes and flowers in their hair, long flowing hair, flowers in their hair, and their serapes and dancing and tripping out to this beautiful music. And they're just like, you know, they act like they're like tripping on heaven or something. And they're all saying, Pied Piper saying, follow me, follow me, follow me. And these are the ones I love, you know, follow this example. You know, that's how it worked. All the models, they would pick these people, examples who were churning, generating all this junk for us, and they'd say, look, this is what make me happy, you know. I might be attracted to you if you're attracted to this. You know, it's all advertising. It's all advertising, models, and all this stuff. Wicked, wicked stuff. Because it misleads you and gets you off the spiritual path, the straight and narrow. Gives you false hope. And you chase after that. And you get into all the subtle stuff, and you don't know what's going on, and you can't sort it out, and you freak out, you go into depression, go into anxiety, or you go into materialism, which is what a lot did. I mean, my generation went from freaking out into freaking materialists, you know? I mean, the baby boomers, you know, are freaking materialists now. I mean, they're spiritual materialists is what they are. Spiritual materialists, you know, they cover their spiritual materialism up by going to see these gurus, you know, and these dime score gurus, and saying, yeah, we're here to build heaven on earth, you know, and you're part of it. You're essential for it, you know. And they say, oh, that's great. I feel great about myself. You know, snatching up houses and all, you know, more materialism stuff. They feel good about themselves because they can go listen to a tape by Baba or something, you know, and that makes them, you know, say, hey, you're on the right path, you know, just, you're building heaven on earth. Isn't that great? So they went from, you know, because they got into the subtle realms where all the drugs and the models and the music and everything, you know, made it all so super cool and sexy, unbelievably cool and sexy and beautiful and subtle. And we all got into that, and then we were lost. Freaked out, completely freaked out, and nothing worked. And then we suddenly realized, oh my gosh, you know, I need to get a hold of something, you know, that's not so subtle. And then they started just picking out on materialism, jumped in and said, let me make as much money as I can, let me get everything I can, let me get my boats, let me get, you know, my cars, my houses, my children under the right college, you know, just totally glommed onto materialism. Yet at the same time, thinking they're still spiritual and cool, you know. Oh no, I'm still real spiritual and cool. I'm on the spiritual path. Not true. Not true at all. No context. No right context at all. You can't do it that way. So let this be a cautionary tale. And hopefully in the future, they will completely reject that path altogether. I said, you cannot have a civilization the way we had civilization set up. You cannot succeed when you are allowing this whole machinery of hooking generations into a subtle realm with no context. You can't have the advertising. You can't have the models. You can't have the musicians. You can't have the drugs. You can't have all this stuff feeding off each other. All an unholy alliance is what happened. Can't have that, because it is literally going to ruin a generation, which then the children to follow think that this is all the way things are supposed to be, and it, you end up with three or four ruined generations, and then you get a world which is just a patty for the subtle, you know, the psychic vampires, the subtle vampires who, you know, want to inflict the brutality and loss on this planet, this planetary sacrifice. You get no resistance. You got no clarity anymore. That's exactly what has happened. It's all been a setup. And I fought against it tooth and nail the whole way. And I was unable to prevent it, unfortunately. Right now, I'm just trying to scare those birds away. Those birds that are able to fly, scare them away before the cat pounces on them. And again, you don't do it by going into the subtle realms. Don't do it that way. At all. Forget it. Forget the stimulants, forget the drugs, forget the tantra, forget all this build a heaven on earth kind of stuff. You don't need any of that. Not needed at all. You simply need an attitude, an orientation. That's it. That is, I need to choose a new cause. That's all you need. You don't, truth is not sitting there waiting for you to explore all these subtle realms and sort it out. Truth could care less about any of the subtle realms. Don't even look at them. No interest whatsoever. It's only looking for your orientation. Willingness. Only looking at your willingness. Are you willing to stop trying to bluff God? Trying to strong arm God? It's trying to strong arm reality. Are you willing to see that's all futile? That's it. That's it. So I'm only teaching this way. That's the only way teaching it works. The other way doesn't work. Doesn't work. It's a disaster. My God. We got a world full of spiritual materialists running the world right now. And then you've got others that are even more that way. Younger generations are super spiritual materialists. You know, again, we can get anything, anytime, where we are. We got our lap, we got our smartphone. We now have got the mobile pay system and just plug into the smartphone, swipe our card. You know, they're even more sophisticated. Just pay online, buy anything, where we are. You know, you're on an island somewhere and you can buy anything, any place in the world, and the plane will bring it to. There you go. You can hang out in your hammock with anything you want, if you have the money. And so super spiritual materialists say, yeah, I can read the Bhagavad Gita here in a hammock on some South Sea island, and yet the plane came in. Oh, you know, I've got a couple cases of you know, some kind of beer from Bavaria or wherever, a microbrewery located, you know, in the highlands of some place, or Costa Rica or lowlands or wherever, right? And you've got the latest, you know, your iPod is all full of the latest music from any place in the world, and you know, you're pulling in everything from all over the world. And here you are in your hammock, you know, looking out over, you know, azure, beautiful ocean with sandy beach, and you're just grooving, reading Bhagavad Gita, and you say, I got it made. And of course, then you got your local drugs there. You know, you got some exotic drugs too. People are really into, spiritual materialists are into exotic drugs. What is it called? Ethnogens, or all the different organic drugs, as it were. Yeah. They're not into the synthetic stuff. They're into the organic stuff. They think, it's organic. It's not a problem. Finding new stuff all the time, you know, to open up other subtle realms, open up this subtle realm, open up that subtle realm, etc. Again, no context. Uh-oh, an EMV truck just went down. Somebody just got sick, fell, died, something up the street. That's why the fire truck went up there. I just saw the EMV going probably to the hospital. Somebody had a problem up there. See? There you go. Welcome to existence. Welcome to existence. So, these spiritual materialists, you know, these people are open up all these subtle realms, thinking they're so cool. There's the ambulance going to the hospital. They're not cool. They're totally uncool. Okay? I'm saying they're totally uncool. I don't have anything to do with them. They're uncool. I've never had anything to do with them. They're uncool. Very uncool. Very foolish. Very much on side trips. And you don't want to go there. You will regret it tenfold going that way. You will regret it bitterly going that way. Don't go that way. Stay on the straight and narrow. Really. And of course, again, not being judgmental, because I'm super aware of the unholy alliance of attractive factors that can pull you into this direction. And they are all utilized on you. So, you know, it takes like a superhuman effort not to get pulled in that direction. And almost everybody does get, to some extent, gets pulled in that direction. What you have to do is minimize it and bounce back and get out of it as fast as possible and stay out of it. And of course, when you become really cool, you lose all your uncool friends who are into that. Only they think... Fire truck. Only they think that you're uncool, and that they're still really cool and you're uncool. But, you know, you lose your uncool friends who think they're cool. You lose those. You part ways with those. But that's great. That's fine. You end up finding spiritual motivators who give you straight talk and get you going, and get you to the point where you can see clearly what needs to be done. Get your orientation right, your context right. It's a lot simpler than you think. You see, when you get lost in those subtle realms, you think it's enlightenment's totally complex and difficult. That's a lie. It's a lie. Enlightenment's totally simple. Choose a new idea. Choose a different cause. Completely simple. But when you go into those subtle realms, subtle energy realms, it becomes unbelievably complex. You feel, oh, somehow I've got to catalog all this. Somehow I've got to creatively channel all this to the world. Somehow I have to learn how to function here. Somehow, you know, it is on and on and on. It's endless. It blows your mind. We call it, you know, having our minds blown. It's all too much. And so you think enlightenment, wow, I have to do all this. And then there's more subtle levels and more and more and more. And you become, oh my God, enlightenment's a long ways off, you know. Nonsense. Enlightenment is simply choosing a different cause, different idea. Giving up the idea of trying to change reality and pick the idea of not trying to change reality. That's all there is. Completely simple. So again, going into any of that subtle stuff is simply going to slow you down and make it seem way more complex than it is, which is a tragedy. Super tragedy. Super tragedy. And we all waste our lives that way. Because if we don't do that, you know, we'd get it. We'd get it. I mean, Ramana just got it. You know, when he was, what, 17 or something. He just said, okay, my body's now grown up enough, so it's time for me, you know, I can leave and do my thing. So he just, the truth was always with him. He's decided, bring it through now. Let's bring it all the way through right now. I'm old enough. And he left home. He just took off, said, I'm leaving. I'm going to go live in Arunachala. And he did it. Because he knew it was completely simple. And he wasn't worried about all those subtle realms. And paying attention to them. When he went to sleep, he went right into the, you know, the deepest oblivious sleep. In other words, oblivion of all the subtle realms. What we're doing, those of us who are still trying to struggle to organize these subtle realms, we go to sleep. We got all this stuff going on. That's what happens to me. And you know, it's just unbelievable complexity in the dreams, because those are accessing the subtle realms, awareness of it. But what we really need to do is just bypass all of that. So when we sleep, not even aware of any of that, and we bring it through like Ramana Maharshi did, he's simply radiating assurance that reality is untouched by any of the subtle stuff. That's it. And we can do that too. We can do it, and eventually we will do that. First, we have to drop all our involvement with all the subtle stuff, thinking that there's some relevance or importance to it. There's none. There's none. So my generation was a generation of idiots. But we got played. Okay. Because there was a whole level, subtle level of functioning that played us severely. You know, and I tried to point that out to everybody. I fought the great fight, saying, hey, we're getting played, you know. And, you know, a lot of those, you know, it was both male and female who were playing us. And I criticized both of them. But what happened was that it became totally uncool to criticize the female part of it, especially when you're young. Like, wow, how can you possibly be so harshly criticizing the female, these beautiful models, you know, these flower children, and they seem so groovy, you know, and like, what an idiot, you know. We said, you know, oh, they're like goddesses. Well, why would you want to criticize them? You're gonna end up with some horrible, ugly woman or something. I said, no, these people are wicked. They're like, you know, demons and demonesses. They're subtle. They're functioning in a subtle way to mislead us. They're like whores of the spirit of subtle realm. The fake spiritual realm, tricking us into this, and it's going to be very bad for us. So, you know, don't pay attention to them. Don't. And, you know, that wasn't listened to. It wasn't listened to. And it continued along this way more and more and more. And what happened was the subtle realm built up all these sacred cows and laws and everything so that you literally cannot criticize these players who are playing us. You can't criticize them because you're accused of hate speech or being sexist or misogynist or all these, you know, ridiculous terms, which really mean don't speak out about those who are setting up this whole sacrifice, who are hooking us into the sacrifice. Don't say anything about it. Don't blow the whistle. Don't spill the beans. That's what essentially it's saying. So we can all be turned into patsies and sacrificed. You know, so it was hard to speak up. It was really hard. You know, you think about, well, why didn't more people speak up like I'm speaking up now? Let me tell you, it was insanely difficult. Insanely difficult. Because you realized that if what you said now is going to be literally viewed in the future as criminal, and you're going to become like the worst criminal ever if you just tell the truth. So, you know, almost nobody spoke up and said what needed to be said. Could not. The threat was too great. You know, basically they say you're going to be cut off from all the subtle realm. Totally cut off from the subtle realm. Literally. That's what they're saying now, too. That's the threat. When you're afraid to speak up and say what needs to be said, be a truth teller, you feel the risk you're running is you're going to be cut off from all the subtle realms. Again, I say, fine. No problem, because I'm going to have access to reality, which is infinitely better than all the subtle realms put together. Can't even compare them. So I'm not afraid about being cut off from the subtle realms. I've been there, done that. I know the subtle realms, you know, they're very groovy. So what? So I have much less fear about being cut off from all of that. You know, the beautiful people will not associate with me. You know. Beautiful models, beautiful people, whatever, you know. I become an anathema, you know, to the subtle realms. Become an anathema. The gods and goddesses will not smile upon me. But that's okay, because I know I'm going to be translated into the paradise realm, the realm that the lost free realm, and then from there back into the fullness of full participation in reacquaintance with reality, functioning in reality the way it's meant to be, which is infinitely better than the subtle realms. So I can speak up, but I understand the threat that we were under. So nobody was really speaking up the right way back that time. Only some great gurus over in India and very, you know, a few places where, but they couldn't really speak to us in the way we needed to be spoke to. Not really. Some Christians spoke up. Okay, some Christians did speak up. Thank you for that. We call them, you know, every term under the sun, like they were nuts. And now they're called, what, bigots? What else? Every word, every pejorative term that anyone can dream up, they're called that. Anyone who dares, you know, to out the sacrifice, as it were, to try and, you know, alert the birds to fly away. Anyone who dares to do that is called every name under the sun, or they're threatened to be, you know, cut out of existence altogether, or put in the lowest hell possible, you know, or every kind of threat under the sun is there, you know. So people are, you know, afraid to speak up, and they're tempering their criticism. Now, you notice that? Even the hardcore Christians are tempering their criticism severely. Say, well, yeah, some of this is okay, but, you know, we're willing to go this far with this, and then, because they're kind of getting worried, you know. They're kind of getting worried. See, they expect Jesus to come back and to, you know, translate them into paradise, and Jesus hasn't come back and done that, so they're getting kind of worried. They're getting worried, losing their nerve. But I say this, whether Jesus comes back or not, the translation into paradise can still happen. Okay, because it is an orientation. It is an attitude. It is a willingness, and anyone can do it at any time, at any place in existence. Okay, simply realize that you have to choose a new cause if you want to escape the effects of this other cause. It's that simple. But will Jesus return and translate many into the paradise? I believe so, definitely. Hasn't happened yet. Probably will happen pretty soon. But will everybody that says Jesus, Jesus, Jesus be translated? No. Only those who have the right context. They're clear about the context. They're clear of what they're doing. They're clear of the direction they're going in and the opportunity, etc., etc. You know, who are not intimidated by the subtle, those who dwell in the subtle realms of energy, you know, cursing them and saying, we're going to cut you off. You'll never work in this town again. You know, it's like in Hollywood, if you dare buck the system, as some have, like, who's that guy? Marlon Brando. There's some have bucked the system and, you know, said some things that Hollywood didn't like. And they said, you'll never work in this town again. I mean, if anybody spills the beans on Hollywood, they'll never work there again. They won't, can't get work. And so it takes a brave soul to do that. A lot of them have so much money, they figure, what the heck, you know, I'm going to go off and live on some island. I'll be fine. I don't care. You know, but it's like that. You know, those who work in the subtle realms of energy, if you say, hey, you know, you're just setting up this sacrifice. You're just, this is a death factory. Existence is a death factory. I don't care about this subtle stuff. They'll say, ah, you know, you're nothing in existence. You'll never be able to have access to these higher subtle realms ever. Yeah, well, that's me. Never have any access to those subtle realms. Even though I can access them. But not welcome there, I guess. I'm ignored. Doesn't matter. Because the paradise realm is infinitely better. I've already experienced that. The lost free realm. Poof. My gosh, that brings up real heart. You talk about heart. If you want your heart activated, just get a glimpse of paradise, okay? Hear all these people talking about heart this, heart that, I'm the heart master, blah, 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 blah. My gosh, how much have we got of that stuff, you know? You need to activate the heart, balance the heart, live in balance, live in harmony, blah, 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 blah. Oh my God, it's all talking about subtle energy stuff. When you get a glimpse, experience of reality, I had more than a glimpse, I had a very strong experience that lasted for quite some time, that activates your real heart, because it activates remembrance and gratitude for that remembrance. And it's like, wow, you're like radiating this tremendous gratitude and feeling of attraction to reality. That's real heart. That is the heart. That's how the heart gets activated. You're not going to get the heart activated in energy, subtle energy, balancing this. You know, the whole teaching about needing to balance. We need to find this balance. Nonsense. That is the worst teaching possible. That's a nightmare. We need to learn to live in harmony. Learn to live in harmony with nature. We must balance our spirit with nature. We must all find the subtle points of balance, how to live in this balance. Ah, my God, that is the worst teaching imaginable. In the paradise realm, there's no such thing as balance or anything like that. You realize, I can't be out of tune with this. It's impossible to be out of tune with this. I'm totally in tune with this because there's no loss, and that's in tune with reality. And reality, I am one with reality. That is my home. So you're naturally in balance with it effortlessly, and you feel this incredible balance in one, and you realize you're completely in tune effortlessly, and you can't lose that attunement. Try that fashion on for style and see how you feel then, and then see how that compares to all this talk about being in tune and in balance with nature, meaning energy, and see which one you like. Try it. Compare. That's what I've done. Compare it. Then you know you can't be fooled. You know, can't be fooled again. You know, the who said, you know, talking about getting fooled again, we won't be fooled again. Well, we certainly were fooled again. We just went from one energy pattern, one level of energy, to a subtler energy level, just completely fooled again. We won't get fooled again. What a joke that was. We definitely got fooled again. Big time fooled again. Oh my gosh. Balance. balance that, you know, there. So, just hearing all this probably is activating a lot of stuff, because if you've lived it, anyone who, my generation, has lived through this, and younger generations, you can tap into this. You're wise. You can say, aha, this is where it came from. Oh, now I see. Wow. Yeah, it's making sense. Now I'm getting it. This whole subtle energy stuff, this whole balance stuff, getting attuned, all this stuff, that's the side trip. That's what distracts me from my real salvation, my real attunement. Yeah, now I'm getting it. So, this is like a very benign spiritual rant here. It's the right kind, I feel it's the right kind of rant. You know, bringing it out in the open. People keep talking about come out of the closet, you know. Well, it's time for truth to come out of the closet, because it's truth that's been stuffed into the closet. As everything else has been coming out of the closet, truth has been stuffed into the closet, you know. As all this darkness has come out of the closet, it stuffs the light into the closet, as it were. As all this, you know, subtle stuff comes out of the closet, it says, oh, no, we can't have the truth, because truth would just pass this subtleness by. No, we're important. Subtlety is important. Subtle energy is important. Balance in these subtle energy fields. We need to learn to dance in these subtle energy fields. That's important. Truth's not important. So the last to come out of the closet is truth. That's the last one to come out of the closet. So that's what we're doing now. Truth is coming out of the closet. That's really cool. That's really cool. That's what's really cool. That's what's really hip. Okay? All this hip stuff was fake. Totally fake. All this cool hipster stuff was totally fake. Just posers. 100% posers. We baby boomers are just posers. Really, most of them. Not all. Some of them, you know, the ones that are really oriented to truth are totally cool. They're scattered around here and there. Really cool. Awesome. Because they're oriented towards truth. And some of the younger people are totally awesome too, because they're oriented to truth. Some of them are just super slick posers. Super slick posers here to build a perfect world, you know. But we're not fooled. Won't get fooled again. Once you get through all this, you won't be fooled again. And that's a great feeling. So, let truth come out of the closet. Come out of the closet. Be a truth teller, right? Be a truth teller. But what's the worst they can do? Ban you from existence. They can't even do that, but they can seem like they can do it. Go ahead. I got reality as a fallback position. Say, you can't listen to any music, can't see any movies, we'll ban you from everything. Go ahead. The experience of reality is infinitely, unimaginably more rich than anything that energy can ever come up with. Period. So don't let them frighten you. Don't let them bluff you. Don't let them bluff you. It's all a bluff. Just because, why? Because they're trying to bluff the Prime Creator. And if you align with the Prime Creator, they're going to try and bluff you, period. They're going to try and bluff you. They're going to try and intimidate you. They're going to try to scare you. Yeah, they're going to come up, even some guru will come up and say, I am God. I am the God on the planet Earth. And here's the way that I'm telling you, you got to go, you know. Don't be intimidated by that either. They say, if you don't worship me as God, I'm going to cut you off from all subtle realms. Well, go ahead. Let's see. They see you do it. Who cares? I don't care. That's happened too, you know. You got even people coming here saying they're Jesus, you know, and if you don't recognize them as Jesus, they're going to cut you off. You're going to cut your salvation off. You can't have access to the subtle realms. You can't have access to the subtle goddess chicks, you know, and all this stuff. And the subtle drugs and the subtle experiences and the subtle happiness and the subtle bliss. And you can't have that. Well, fine. Good. Great. Thank you. But I don't need you to cut me off from it. I'll set it down myself. When I choose a new idea, a new cause, I'll automatically set it all down. Automatically, piece of cake. Gently settled down. Gratefully, blissfully, gently settled down. And in this place, unconditional love, in the loss-free realm, in this utterly effortless attunement to it. Beyond any attunement we could ever even imagine with nature, with the energy world. Effortless attunement. Wow. That is a trip. You want a trip? That's a trip. You want to go on a real trip? Go on that trip. You want to be a real hippie? Go on a real trip. Okay, you want to be a totally cool hipster? Go on that trip. Then you'll really be cool. Because you'll have effortless attunement with your environment. Effortless attunement, and you can't lose it. Try that trip on for style, right? Try those groovy threads on for style. All right, very great. That's it for this video. And as they like to say, Namaste.